It's Tuesday, January 22nd, 2013. I'm Marty Owings. Welcome to Capital Conversations. Tonight on the program, we're pleased to be joined by a couple of guests from the House tonight. We have Democrat Mike Nelson. He's a House member in his sixth term joining us. Welcome, Representative Nelson.
Thank you.
And also former House member Mark Biskins, a Republican who served in the legislature from 1999 till just last year, 2012.
Yeah, absolutely. And my house now is somewhere down on Selby Avenue.
Right. You used to reside in Jordan, and your district was down there, and now you moved up here.
Well, and a pretty interesting phenomena this past November when I lived in Jordan, about 95% of what I voted for won. When I voted here in St. Paul, I got shut out.
Right. Well, some have speculated you might have moved here to try to run.
Well, but, you think?
Just saying. Tonight we're pleased, to be joined by these two gentlemen. But later in the program, we'll be joined by Professor David Schultz from Hamline University. He's written a number of books on politics, and so we're happy he'll be joining us to talk about his books. And one of his books, his most recent, American Politics in the Age of Ignorance. Why lawmakers choose belief over evidence. Oh, you guys are in for it.
That's a good
and
one.
Then Paul Demko from Politics in Minnesota will drop by to give us a breakdown of the governor's budget proposal today. Okay, let's get started, gentlemen. The governor released his budget today, and that's the focus up here. That's what everybody's talking about today. That's the buzz. Just some brief statistics, and we can talk about it. The budget calls for $38 billion in spending, which is about roughly a $1 billion increase from what was we were expected to spend. That's $2.1 billion in tax increases, which are quite substantial. 25% increase in student aid, $300 million for K-12, a 14% reduction in corporate taxes, according to the governor's paperwork, and $500 property tax rebate. Costing about $1.4 billion to the state, but it sounded, I think that got most people's attention. And, you know, most DFLers reacted positively to the governor's proposals, but maybe they were hesitant on a few of those tax on clothing and whatnot, lowering the sales tax. What was your reaction?
I think overall it was positive. I mean, you can always pick out any, whether you agree with everything or not, you can always pick out something to argue against, but for the overall, it was positive. We're trying to lower the burden on property taxes, not only on the citizens, but also on businesses. I mean, that's been the last few years we've been cutting government or state programs, we've been downloading some of those programs to local cities and counties, and their only source of income is property taxes, so the property taxes have been going back up, and this kind of lowers it back down. I mean, they've talked for years about the three-legged stool of our tax system, the sales tax, the income tax, and the property tax. In the last few years, the leg on that property tax stool has gotten rather long, and this is kind of a way to balance that out so that we have a level table and kind of spread it around all the major taxes that we collect.
Your reaction?
Well, I saw the governor's little cartoon with the three-legged stool, and at the end of the day, I think it's a little deceiving. And bottom line, and I'm glad the representative wants to talk at a high level and not into the minutia, because that's where people are. You know? And at the end of the day, government is going to increase the revenue by about 8%, and they're going to increase the spending by about 17%. And I think that is the absolute wrong direction to go. And I think it's going to have continue to exacerbate a problem that we've had both under Republican majority and now under DFL majority, that we just simply cannot rein in the growth of government. And until we get serious about that, we're not going to get serious about fixing the problems that are inherent in our system.
Well, let me ask you a question about that directly, Representative Nelson, as long as Representative Biskins brought it up. We talk about these cuts to LGA and how that drove property tax up. You said that the property tax is really the only form, but I think when I open my cable bill, I see all these local taxes. They must collect taxes on local sales tax and other taxes, right? I mean, it's just not property tax. And isn't a $500 rebate the least progressive kind of way to address property tax reform?
And again, I'm not getting into the minutia of it because I don't know all the details of it, but it's a way to give people the money back that directly to everybody in the state is, mm-hmm. and it's everybody's going to get benefit from that. That's my understanding is the reason for it. But yeah, local governments, they basically can raise property taxes. And there's a few local sales taxes we put on, the cable bills and all those things. Those are our access fees, but those are, for the most part, it's the local property taxes, what our cities and our school districts and our counties, that's okay. how they raise their taxes.
Well, and to me, one of the problems we have right now in our government is we have an intermeshing of the units of government. The income tax, sales tax was supposed to fund state government. The property taxes was supposed to fund local government. And when we have the state intervening in the property tax and they take it for state purposes and then they take sales tax to buy down local government spending is when we create a confusion where nobody can figure out who is doing what. If you really want reform, if you're really talking about honest reform, then there should be a wall between government spending and local spending, so that local decisions made by locally elected people should be reflected on the property tax, and state decisions and regional, because we got to throw the Met Council, and God bless you for having oversight of them, Representative, and I know you'll do a good job. Those decisions have to be paid for by those folks, but we keep actually, local government aid, buying down property tax from the state actually covers up local decisions, and there's a problem with that, and one we have to address in the big picture.
Well, what about it, Representative Nelson? It's some of the specifics. At least we can get into a couple of these.
Okay.
This governor's proposed a tax on maybe expensive clothes, I guess at $100. I don't know how expensive that is anymore. But and some other taxes that seemed maybe there. I hear about the internet sales tax going around, the Amazon tax, as they call it.
And I don't know all the details. Yeah. But I've had a chance to look at. I've been in committees all day, so I haven't.
No excuse for not on the budget inside and out, Representative.
The day after, yeah. Well, again, yeah.
It just came out today.
It just came out today, and it came out this morning. But it's the idea behind spreading the sales tax out, it's lowering the rate of the sales tax. We're lowering it from 6.875 to 5.5. Yeah. So we're going to lower the rate, and they're going to spread it out to clothing, and it's not going to go on food. I mean, there was a lot of people who were worried about that. It's just going to be on clothing, and those are for items over $100. Mm-hmm. So if I buy three pair of pants for $25 or $30, they're not going to get taxed, even though the total cost is going to be over $100. It's just going to be if I buy three pair of pants for $20 and then I buy a sport coat for $105, the sport coat will get charged. And it's I think Representative, or former Representative Biskins here he'll agree with me that it shouldn't be a discussion. I've been saying this since the first time I ran. It shouldn't be a discussion about what we charge in taxes or how we tax. I mean, we can have differences in how that's done. The decision has to be made on what we're going to provide for services and what services our citizens demand from us. When they want these things and they say we need to have these things done, we should have that argument every session, every election cycle of what services we want our government to provide. Do we want the snow plowed when there's 6 inches of snow, or do we want to wait till there's a foot of snow to send the plows out? Do we want 10 cops in our city, or do we want to go back to 8 and have to wait longer for response times? All these things are decisions that we should discuss all the time, and that's a discussion and an argument we should have every year. And then when we decide this is the level of service we want, we have to come up with a system, a fair system that everyone pays their fair share, that pays for it. Sort of like going to a restaurant. You go to a restaurant and you pay, when you order something off the menu, you got to pay for it. And you can't decide, well, I want that steak dinner, but I only want to pay for the hamburger. You know, we can't do that. And that's kind of what we've been doing the last 10 years, going back almost to the Ventura administration when they made changes in the underlying structure. We've been fighting that for the last 10 years. We've had this structural imbalance. Every 2 years, there's this deficit because we haven't paid for what we decided we wanted to do. So we end up with all these gimmicks that we have.
You guys are all mired and mixed up in this dysfunction we call government up here. So none of you are clean, right?
No.
Media, we're clean. Hey, Representative Biskins, I was going to ask you a question about this, though. And you alluded to it, Representative Nelson. Governor says, I'm elected on the strength that I said to the folks out there, I'm going to reform government, you know, in terms of taxation and stuff, going to make it fair and balanced, eliminate shifts and gimmicks. Would you stipulate to that, that the governor is trying to address that somehow in his, you know, reformation, if you will, of the tax system and try to get it to be more fair?
No, and thank
you. Even if
you
disagree with it?
Thank you, because I, you know, throw a bone out to the governor. He has been incredibly honest and has been a man of integrity. He has said from day one, that's what he wants to do. He wants to raise the taxes on income levels to at X amount. He wants to increase, he didn't say he wanted to broaden the sales tax. I think when he had a debate with then candidate Horner, said, no, candidate Horner's idea of broadening the sales tax was wrong. But the governor has said we need more money, and while, you know, X or Y poll will say that's a bad way to go, he has stuck to it. And so I throw out kudos to the governor for doing that. And in fact, I will say that's probably, in my mind, one of the big reasons why the Republicans lost their majority this year, is because they came in 2 years ago and said, we're going to cut government spending. We're going to reduce the size of government spending, and a government spending increased by between $4 to $6 billion over the biennium. So governor has stood by his word, and kudos to that.
So hang on, let's just make that point clear. You're saying if the Republicans would have stuck to what they ran on campaign wise in terms of the cuts, that you think they would have been put back into office?
I absolutely believe that. And you'll hear Republican after Republican say, well, we didn't get our message out and X, Y, or Z. But,
well, the amendments, your own Republican analysts. Julianne Ortman said the other day on NPR, the Republican Party's on life support. I'm paraphrasing, but I think that's what you said.
I don't get that. Yeah. And you know, you do have people say, well, it was the amendments. Well, if that's true, how come the marriage amendment actually was out-supported statewide than Republican candidates?
Oh, you mean in greater Minnesota?
Well, no. You take all the votes throughout the state of Minnesota for Republican candidates in the legislature and for the marriage amendment. The marriage amendment actually outpolled them.
Well, I guess that ship sailed, right, Representative Biskins?
It has. Yeah. It has. But I think what the voters appreciate more than anything else is integrity. I mean, I came to the legislature 14 years ago with a pretty hard right stance, and had good support. And you wouldn't believe how many times I would run into constituents who say, you know, Representative, I don't agree with a word you say, and yet I appreciate so much the fact that you stand by your word. Yeah. And that's what I think people are missing a lot in the legislature, but that's what the governor brings. Right? He stood by his word, and people respect that. They may not agree with it. I don't agree with it, but gosh darn it, I respect it.
So, Representative Nelson, we've established that Representative Biskins isn't going to get a lot of Wellstone voters in his corner, but are you going to be able to reach out to the independents, in terms of this budget? Do you think it'll resonate with those people that helped the Democrats get control of the legislature?
I think Representative Biskins brings up a good point, is that it's integrity. The governor said, this is what I'm going to do. He's been trying to do this since he was first elected. And you bring up Wellstone. I mean, and I go back to Bosowicz the same way. A lot of people, Democrats, didn't like Bosowicz, didn't like all of what he stood for, but he did what he said he was going to do, and he didn't change his tune. And Wellstone the same way. A lot of Republicans didn't like Wellstone, but they gave him kudos that he did. He said what he said, and he stood by what he believed, and he stood up for it. So I think the independents in here, if we can And that's what the governor's trying to do with this budget, is take care of the structural imbalance in this budget, going out in 2 years and 4 years, that we're not going to be having another deficit 2 years from now and 4 years from now, that if we can get this thing passed, then we can put the state back on the prosperity that we've been in the past, where we have stable budgets, so we're not, every time the economy goes up or down, mm-hmm. we're not having to either cut everything to the bone again, or conversely raise taxes to fill that hole that's there, that we can have a more stable budgeting system, and then we can work on greater reforms in the system.
Well, fair enough. Before we get to, we've got some internet questions for you guys. Some viewers have sent in some internet questions, but before we get to those, final question on that for both of you. Did the governor's budget that he announced today, did anything in that budget surprise either one of you?
To me, I was flabbergasted that he would raise the taxes on cigarettes by, what was it, 95 cents a pack.
Something like that, yeah.
An incredibly regressive tax that hits the poorest the hardest. I believe that the numbers that he is calculating bringing in are made off of a static model of budget projections, and I think the number that he brings in is about as realistic as a number the legislature saw just a few months ago when we passed a Viking stadium based on electronic pull tabs.
You say that's not working out so well.
I think I called it foo-foo and fairy dust then, right? And I'm going to stand by that.
Okay, fair enough.
And the cigarette tax, there's actually two policies going in there. We try to discourage people from smoking because it decreases our long-term obligation for health care. And by raising the money on that, there's an inverse, and he's right, you're not going to raise as much money as you think off that because there's sort of an inverse thing there. The more higher you raise it, the less people smoke, mm-hmm. and actually the revenues go down or stay flat. So it's there may be fairy dust there,
if it's the less people will smoke, Mike. I think it's the more people will go buy their cigarettes out of state, get them online, go to...
Statistics have shown that people, the higher you raise the tax, the more people use that as an excuse to quit smoking.
So well, you guys just have so many tools in your toolbox. It seems like this tobacco thing comes up all the time mm-hmm. as a way to try to... Well, I think we'll invite... Cliff, we want to swing in here with some questions from the internet so these gentlemen can read them. What do you got?
Our first question comes...
You'll have to shout because we're near deaf. We're all old. Well, not Mr. Nelson, but Biskins and I
are ancient. Yeah, we're old.
Okay, the first question then is from Callie Stair, and it's, why doesn't the Minnesota legislator and or governor add liquor tax increases in budget? People drink booze and smoke.
I guess I don't know. I don't know why they chose cigarette taxes as opposed to alcohol taxes. I don't know.
Well, and I'm not going to get into the mind of the governor and decide this is his preference or not. The bottom line is, do you believe government needs to have more money?
Right.
Or do you believe government has reached a point where it should reevaluate the very things that it does and if it's maybe doing too much? And that's a discussion we need to have, and that's a discussion that's not being brought out in this governor's budget.
Any other questions?
Yeah, we had one other question, and this is actually about the Department of Corrections. And the question is, why is the Minnesota Department of Corrections allowed to hide its risk assessments under state law?
Either one of you gentlemen familiar with that?
I don't know. I haven't sat on those committees, so I don't know the answer to that.
And I'm very ill-informed. That usually doesn't stop me from talking on something, but this time I'll hold back.
Well, we don't screen the question, so we, you know,
understood.
Which is fair to the viewers. They get to ask whatever they want. So
understood.
You know what, Cliff? As a commitment to that person, we'll try to get back to them with a lawmaker that might know the answer. And who's on the criminal justice committee?
I would say Representative Hillstrom is the chair of the Judiciary Committee, and Representative Paymar. Representative Paymar would be the other one that might have the answer to those questions.
All right, some quick-fire questions for you gentlemen before we let you go. I have to wrap it up because we got Professor David Schultz to talk about this dysfunction up
here. So you're going to bring intelligence.
We're trying to raise the IQ a little, believe me. I'm completely unarmed when it comes to that. But okay, for each of you, who's one person from the other side of the aisle, and this could be a former or current colleague, that you might respect or admire, your opponents?
For me, I'd say Representative Gunther. And Representative Biskind, I always enjoyed having a committee with
him. You can't pick Biskins,
but Representative Gunther's always been one that he's a reasoned approach, and we don't agree on some things, but we come to the meeting of the minds on a lot of things.
Representative Gunther?
Okay. And for me, I'd say Representative Nelson, because he's sitting to my side here. And thank you. That means a lot, and I have enjoyed our debates, and they've been good. But also, an Iron Ranger, now retired, came to his senses as well. Tom Rukavina and I got along very, very well. That was our libertarian streak, where East met West all the way on the other side of the sphere, at the very bottom of the circle.
Yeah, I understand that about you two. Both supported the Flag in America deal.
Yeah.
Well, let's make it here, not in China, right?
There's other things we support.
What, if any, hobbies do you to have that might people might find interesting besides vacationing in exotic places, Mr. Biskins? But what hobbies might you have?
Well, as a
Democrat, who writes these questions?
I don't know. As a Democrat, I enjoy hunting and the outdoors and
use a gun for that.
Yes, and
you just went off my list. Gun loving Democrat. Can't interview him anymore. No, I'm just teasing you, Representative Nelson.
I don't know. I tell you, my latest hobby is trying to figure out this dark world called the Facebook. Holy buckets!
Oh, that thing will suck
you in. An interesting journey.
We call it the Facebook.
Yeah, Facebook.
last question, gentlemen. Just briefly, why did you enter politics, Representative Nelson, Representative Biskins?
I was always active and involved. I mean, I was active in my labor union and my local union and got involved in politics that way and was always kind of interested in it, even going back to high school. And I find out more and more that just because I read and I followed stuff that I'm more of a wonk than I ever thought I was, because things come up and I go, people ask questions and I've read about that. So I guess I've always been interested in it, and fortunately I always had good candidates in my district till the legislator I had, Darlene Luther, passed away, and people in the district asked me to run, and so I ran and got elected here. So,
did you serve beforehand in another capacity in government?
Nope, I did not.
Okay, was your first?
This is my first crack.
You went right from 0 to 60. Representative Biskins, I think I remember your story.
Yeah, very long story.
Might have been involved a lot of.
Well, it involved volunteer firemen solving world's problems with adult beverages in a back room, and them saying we need more volunteer firemen on the city council, and they looked at me and said, Biskins, you're the youngest, so you're running for city council.
Okay.
And the rest is history.
How long did you serve on the city council?
I served on it for 2 years of a four-year term before I was cajoled and harangued.
Into running.
Really lose my mind and run for the legislature.
You like low pay and abuse.
I'm getting better.
Clearly, yeah. Right. Well, that's all we have time for tonight, gentlemen. I want to thank you both for taking the time to come on tonight and schedule changes.
Thank you
both. Coming up, Professor David Schultz talks to us about all the political news from up here at the Capitol, including his new book, Fresh Off the Presses. We'll talk to him. And then stay tuned later on in the show. We'll have a visit from Paul Demko from Politics in Minnesota. He'll give us his take on the governor's budget. We'll be right back after this.